It is very active in McLaren these days as we prepare for the Singapore Grand Prix, with the team finding big gains in the brand new wind tunnel, but also some drama brewing up in Woking. The recent rumors about Lando potentially leaving the team might have shaken up the positive atmosphere at McLaren, but as they say, they are fully focused on their goal this weekend. Let's take a look at what we can expect from the team in orange in Marina Bay this year. They started the season really badly, admitting that the car did not come out as they expected, which was in turn reflected in their results. However, when they introduced the upgrades in Silverstone and Lando and Oscar finished P2 and P4 respectively, everyone was surprised, to say the least. This continued in the next race in Hungary, and McLaren really was on the rise, prompting many pundits and people in the F1 world to give them credit for their turnaround this season. However, their resurgence was apparently only for a few races because they haven't managed to impress ever since that Hungarian Grand Prix. And with the recent rumors that Lando might be joining Red Bull, it is right to expect that things might be moving in a bad direction for the Papaya team. It's worth mentioning that the team was building a brand new wind tunnel in the Woking factory, which has now finally started working, so we can expect them to have a state-of-the-art facility to develop their cars in the future. McLaren team principal Andrea Stella has pointed out that the team's recently inaugurated wind tunnel in Woking offers significant advantages in terms of logistics and financial efficiency. Previously, the team utilized Toyota's facility in Cologne for several years, necessitating the transportation of all parts to Germany, which proved to be less efficient. With the new wind tunnel now operational, testing for the 2024 car is already underway. Stella is eager to witness the early season insights gleaned from this facility translate into tangible benefits for the team, underscoring the pivotal advantages it brings. Thanks to the understanding and knowledge we generated at the start of the season once we started working on the upgrades, we realized that we do need to evolve the chassis and some other aspects of the car layout in order to further exploit the aerodynamics, Stella told the media. The more you know, the more you can do. After year one, most of the layout elements we continued with from year one to year two because we didn't know enough as to what was possible. Now we're more knowledgeable and therefore we will have to actually modify the layout of the car for next year and cash in on more aerodynamic benefits. Stella is really confident about the next season's car, and with good reason, in my opinion, because a lot of teams now know what it takes to succeed in this era of regulations, and having a bleeding-edge factory helps you immensely, which is what Stella confirmed in the interview. We started working on developing the 2024 car in the new wind tunnel, and this process has been very smooth, to be honest. We were ready to face some anomalies and scratch our heads, but in reality, there has been really good continuity between the work we were doing at Toyota and the work we're doing at the McLaren Technology Center. Obviously, it comes with a massive advantage from a logistical point of view and from financial savings. But this is where the fun and games end for McLaren, as there has been some drama going on, albeit with a somewhat unimportant person in the grand scheme of things, and that is their reserve driver Alex Palou. The Spaniard was supposed to be McLaren's test driver this Friday during FP1 in Singapore, but it seems like he will not show up, considering he and the team are involved in a legal battle in a UK court, with Brown claiming Palou has a signed contract for 2024 and that he has received an advance on 2024 wages. After securing the IndyCar title at Portland last weekend, Palou's current team, Chip Ganassi Racing, has officially confirmed that he will continue with them for the upcoming season. It's worth noting that last year, Palou initially expressed intentions to leave Ganassi to join McLaren. However, a legal dispute was resolved out of court, allowing Palou to remain with Ganassi while also affording him the opportunity to engage in Formula One testing in conjunction with his role as the McLaren-endorsed reserve driver supported by Ganassi. Asked how the Palou situation has changed McLaren's F1 plans, Brown said, "He's still our reserve driver. So that's changed because I don't think he's going to show up in Singapore, which he's obligated to. But we have had a couple of different reserve drivers during the year, so we're now going to have to extend that." According to Brown, he personally hasn't received a single word from Pillow since the situation unfolded. When asked about his level of disappointment, Brown expressed, "It's pretty surprising, both the situation itself and how it's been handled. That's perhaps the most unexpected aspect of all." Brown noted that his initial concerns about Pillow's commitment were raised during IndyCar's month of May in Indianapolis. However, it wasn't until the Nashville race that his suspicions were confirmed. He also mentioned that he had received reassurances from the Pillow camp about their agreement on multiple occasions, including as recently as the Nashville IndyCar round last month. This was just 1 week before Brown publicly stated that Pillow had reneged on his commitment to switch to McLaren. McLaren also has Mick Schumacher available as a reserve driver through an arrangement with Mercedes, and they have additional backup plans in place. McLaren has another driver familiar with Formula One, Pato O'Ward, who participated in an FP1 session at Abu Dhabi for McLaren last year, and he will be in the car for an FP1 later this year and attending the F1 races in his native Mexico, Austin, Las Vegas, and Abu Dhabi. I can really see both sides' perspectives here. From Pillow's perspective, obviously this was handled in a messy way, but his dream was F1, and you can't make it to F1 without having the mindset of being willing to do absolutely anything it takes. When it became apparent there wasn't an obvious path to a McLaren seat anytime soon, it made total sense to prioritize the best seat in IndyCar, which, if I'm being honest, one would much rather have than an AlphaTauri or something on that level. McLaren has made an impressive splash in IndyCar, but it's still not a top-level team. I can see why Alex was only willing to do this if it meant a realistic upper midfield F1 shot. Who wouldn't do that? From McLaren's perspective, it really does not look good. They wanted this guy because he's an amazing driver, and it kind of seems like he signed a contract, which is pretty straightforward. But that's life, and Zak Brown is right to be upset and call out Pillow for defaulting, but I'm sure the court will have something to say and we'll move on. This is maybe even better for Alex Pillow, who had no guaranteed spot in F1 next season, as both Lando and Oscar will be driving for the team barring any unforeseen circumstances, for which there have been rumors as Lando was said to have favorited Red Bull and might potentially leave the team even before his contract runs out. The British driver is bound by a long-term contract with the Woking-based team, securing his presence until 2025, and McLaren CEO Zak Brown has emphatically stated that there are no escape clauses in Norris's agreement. However, despite this, rumors have been gaining traction throughout the year, suggesting that Norris could be a potential target for Red Bull as a replacement for Sergio Perez. These speculations have gained further momentum, particularly after Max Verstappen expressed openness to racing alongside Norris if the British driver ever chose to switch to Red Bull, as they're known to be very good friends. Should Norris make the switch, then I believe neither Pillow nor O'Ward would get a chance, but who knows how the situation might develop because there are also many other experienced drivers on the list for Stella. McLaren are building something here, and under the leadership of Andrea Stella, it might as well happen that we see them as contenders in the near future. But that's just how it looks from the outside. If Lando speaks about potentially leaving the team, then maybe he sees and knows something the rest of us don't. I think it would not be a good idea to leave the team at this point, but things change in Formula One very fast, so maybe we will see a massive change in the pecking order very soon. For now, McLaren needs to finish the season on a high, try at least to get P3 in the standings for that prize money fund, and work hard during the off-season to create the best car possible. Let us know your thoughts. Do you think McLaren should have dealt with this situation better, or was this the best they could do? Thanks for watching, and we will see you in the next video.